John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you here in the backyard garden here in March. And I got a special guest, Wendy, of Wendyland. And Wendy, what are we doing today?
We are cooking and eating.
We're cooking and we're making some food because it's important for us as gardeners to eat the food that we grow. So we're going to use the majority of what we are making today, the food that I grew here in my very garden. And teach you guys some healthy recipes, because as much as you guys grow the food, I want you guys to grow the food and not only grow it, but eat it too. And I know Wendy's a big fan of this. A lot of the stuff she grows, she also eats and has more experience making all kinds of different dishes than I would make. So Wendy, if somebody wants to learn more about you and your channel, because Wendy has her own gardening channel on YouTube that gets lots of views and I'm subscribed, and you should subscribe to her too. How can they learn more about you?
At Wendyland. So it's W-E-N-D-I-L-A-N-D.
Link down below in the description as well. So Wendy, tell us more about like how you use some of the food you grow in your garden.
Yeah, I grow a lot of different kinds of herbs and greens and some Asian herbs and some smaller things like tomatoes and different varieties. But I do a lot of juicing with the greens and then or smoothies. Sometimes I do cook them and I do some steaming too. I got like sweet potatoes I harvest or even some sunchokes. And in fact, John also grows those, so
yep, absolutely.
That's the recipe.
Yeah, so I mean, I grow, as you know, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, and this time of year in March, I have endless and copious amounts of leafy greens to eat, and I'm working on using them all. Some of them are bolting, actually, right now, too. But I usually at least juice them, I'll blend them into smoothies, I'll dry them, dehydrate them. Actually, I got to do a batch of dehydrated greens pretty soon to make some kale chips. I also will actually cook some of the bolting tops. I've been doing that lately in the Instant Pot, steaming them. They're quite delicious, and being able to include more greens in my diet is super important. And I want you guys to grow more greens in your garden, but also eat more greens in your life. Greens are the number one superfood on the entire planet, and most Americans, unfortunately, do not eat enough greens. And greens can get expensive in the store, and plus they don't travel and ship well, and they taste horrible from the store. And, you know, the greens in my garden taste so sweet, they taste so mineral, and they taste so amazing. Any comments on that, Wendy? Because you've had some greens from my garden today, and you've had greens from your garden and greens from the store and other places. What would you say about the greens in my garden?
They are definitely a lot fuller in spectrum. The flavor is more full, more like heavy that mineral taste. So you get a lot more flavor and depth when you're the more you chew, the more it's like expressing, I guess, all the different flavors comes out. And sunchokes were sweeter than the one I grow.
Well, I try to grow really, I mean, it's not just sweetness, but it's also, I think the minerals really add to the nutrition and also create a better sweetness, probably, and also having better soil. You know, so it's all the things that I teach you guys on my channel, all the products that I use, that I teach you guys about, will, you know, grow you guys higher quality plants that'll be, more disease and stress resistant. Not affected by as much by pests, and also grow healthier food for you in the end. And actually, that is why I started garden, to have the healthiest food that money cannot buy. And that's why I grow a garden. That's why I take the time to invest in my soil bank account, you know, so I could grow healthy stuff. And that's what I want you guys to do as well. So anyways, I guess the first thing, Wendy, is we're going to do two different recipes. What are you going to be making today for everybody?
I am going to be making taco sort of a thing. So we're going to use the leafy greens that John grows here as a wrap. And then I'm just going to do a little bit of cooked food and mixing up with some raw foods and have a really nice dressing with it.
Wonderful. And then what I'll be making is I'll be making something super simple that I want all you guys to do that are growing your greens and you just find yourself not eating them that much. You can make a salad, you could cook greens up, but the easiest thing to do is to make a smoothie with them. So I'm going to be making a simple green smoothie with greens from my garden, as well as starting with some orange juice that was just fresh pressed that I made myself, although I didn't grow the oranges. I do grow some lemons, but you know, most of you guys have orange juice already in your fridge because it's the number one juice consumed in the United States, and we'll make a very quick and simple and delicious way to include more greens in your diet today. All right, Wendy, so let's get started. I think first, since it's gonna take you a little bit longer to cook some of this stuff, we're gonna go ahead over to the outdoor prep table and show you guys how she's gonna start preheating and cooking some of the ingredients in her recipe that I actually grew. These are sunchokes I grew myself, and also the sweet potatoes I grew myself as well, and Wendy's already pre-cut them. So what are we doing, Wendy?
We are going to be steaming them in the pressure cooker.
All right, yeah, you could steam them on a stove. And how would somebody steam them in a stove? Because I never do that. I don't. My stove doesn't work.
Yeah, I usually steam them whole, or at least cut it in half, just keep them in bigger chunks so the flavor wouldn't leach out as much. Yeah, and steam it that way. I think that's the best way to go, so it wouldn't dry out. Whereas you can roast it too, but you'd have to wrap it in a foil or something just to let it not dry out. So best way, I think, is to steam it, and usually it takes like 20 minutes or something. You can always poke it with a fork to make sure it like goes through.
And then I usually cook all my potatoes and everything in an Instant Pot. It just makes things so much easier. And for me, if you're pre-cutting it, I mean, it could be done in like 3 minutes, like on the manual pressure setting for 3 minutes. And then it basically heats up to pressure, gets pressure for 3 minutes, and then it basically cools down and lets the pressure release, you know, naturally. And then it's pretty much done.
Okay, should I get started?
Yeah, so we could move this up. I'll hold it up, and you could kind of
take the knife, put the knife down.
You could funnel them in there.
Thank
All right,
you.
So these are purple sweet potatoes I grew in my garden. I want to encourage you guys, it's almost time, start your purple sweet potato slips right now so that you could be growing them in your garden. Of course, if you live in the tropics, you could grow these year-round.
Yeah.
And they grew so crazy last year, like it was not fun digging them up in the cold weather, so I'm going to probably do them if I grow sweet potatoes again in pots. She's also putting in the sunchokes that I grew. So Wendy, why do you cook your sunchokes? Because I oftentimes eat them raw myself.
I often eat them raw too, but sometimes I like them to be a little different because they have like a potato kind of a texture when it's cooked. So they're soft. Yeah, so it does have really good flavor. Some people like to even roast them just like potatoes, you know? So we can do, I've decided to do half. We're going to take some and leave it kind of crunchy and eat it raw because they are really good raw. I feel like it's almost like wasteful to be cooking this.
And my sunchokes are so sweet, like.
Yeah, they taste almost like water chestnut, these ones.
Yeah, I mean, all the sunchokes I grow, yeah, taste so good, like so sweet.
Yeah. I'm just going to leave these and then.
And you're going to chop them up later.
Yeah.
All right, great.
Okay, let's put it on.
So basically we got a little bit of water in the Instant Pot with like a little standoff and a stainless steel tray in there. All right, lock it in place, makes a few noises.
Okay, and then let's...
She's clicking the manual button and then...
Setting the minutes. Yeah.
Yeah, it drops, it defaults to 30. And she's gonna crank it down all the way to 3 minutes. She's gonna let it go.
All right.
And then you just walk away, and the Instant Pot does all the work for us. So while that's cooking, I'm gonna get started on my recipe, which is basically I'm doing that green smoothie. So she's gonna follow me around with the camera, and we're gonna pick my ingredients. So here in my cool season garden, I have basically like 20 of these round circular beds, and the reason why I use the round circular beds is because I got them at Walmart for like $10, like many years ago, and as long as you don't step on them, they actually hold pretty well. And I got lots of different greens. So what greens am I gonna use today? Well, I'm gonna use probably these guys first. And these guys are the komatsuna, or they call it also mustard spinach. I like it because it grows really fast. Check a link down below. This is one of the greens you guys wanna grow if you haven't started growing it yet, because it's gonna come on really quick. You're gonna have lots of greens to eat. I've harvested this back like multiple times and it just keeps sprouting up new growth. So I always like to just come around and pick some of the ones on the edges because it grows from the centers. And these guys are already starting to bolt too if you guys look closely, but I've been popping them off as they bolt and cooking them on up so then they'll continue to grow just a little bit more so I could stretch out my season. So we'll probably grab a good dozen of these mustard spinach or komatsuna leaves. So the next green I'm gonna harvest is from my spinach bed. I got basically like 35 plants in here and the spinach is looking really good. I love to let my spinach grow, and man, I tell you guys, the spinach you guys grow at home is like so much better, sweeter than the store-bought spinach that you just buy like organic in those little tubs. Like that stuff's garbage. This tastes so sweet, so delicious. And of course, Popeye ate his spinach. Rich in minerals, protein, and nutrients. Now the thing is, if you guys have kidney stones, you guys wanna avoid the spinach. Spinach is higher in oxalates as well as things like chard and beet greens. So you wanna minimize that. Just because they have oxalates, it doesn't mean that I'm scared of a mole. Like, oh, I'm not going to eat it because it has oxalates, right? In nature, if we lived in, you know, sub-Saharan Africa and we ate a lot of wild greens, we would have the proper bacteria in our guts that will dissolve and eat the oxalates. But most Americans don't eat greens, thus probably don't have the good microbiome to digest those greens. So, yeah, avoid them if you have kidney stones. Otherwise, you know, I'm not going to make the whole thing out of spinach like many people into health foods might. But I'm going to pick, you know, once again, a good dozen leaves because there's good nutrients in spinach despite the oxalates. Now, the thing I want to let you guys know is that the other greens I'm using today, right, are in the brassica family of plants. The brassica greens, like the komatsuna, like mizuna, like bok choy, like kale and collard greens, all those are in the brassica family, and they have significantly lower levels of oxalates than the spinach. So when I'm harvesting, I just go around to each plant and I harvest some of the lower leaves on each one. Maybe just one or two leaves off each plant. The plant doesn't miss it and continues to grow, so I can continue to eat my spinach all season long. All right, so the next bed I'll be harvesting from is the one that gets the most sun. And as you guys can see, I got some like purplish broccoli coming up. Probably got some maybe cauliflower somewhere in here. But I'm harvesting another one of my brassica beds. This bed has things like this kale right here, which is known as Casper kale. No, this is not ornamental kale. This is Casper kale. It's supposed to be a really sweet kale. And I really love the color on it. It actually is an early bolter. Also, I've been underwatering my garden lately due to watering restrictions and whatnot. So things bolt a little bit more quickly. So we're going to harvest a bunch of this white Casper kale. It tastes a lot like lettuce, supposedly. Let's go ahead and try it, actually. I've only tried a few leaves so far this year. So I taste the kale, but it's like really mild. I'm getting actually a lot of sweetness, actually. I'm not gonna say it tastes like lettuce, but it's probably one of the mildest and sweetest kales that I've ever tasted. Also, of course, it's growing in my garden, so things in my garden just happen to be sweeter due to my growing practices. Now, the other thing I want to let you guys know, besides, you know, growing kale and different kinds of kale, I got the white Casper kale, but then also we got this kale, which is like the red boar kale, and actually it's like a purple color. I want to encourage you guys to grow your purple vegetables, right? Link down below to a video I made on why every gardener should grow some purple vegetables. They are super nutritious. They're even more nutritious than the white or green vegetables. Now, the next thing I'm going to harvest is Brussels sprouts. So I grew red Brussels sprouts this year, and you're like, John, there's no Brussels sprouts. Well, you could see them on the little stalk starting to form, but even though the Brussels sprouts aren't fully harvested and they were actually bolting, so I cut off the bolting tops and ate them, we could harvest our red Brussels sprout leaves. So yes, you could harvest your Brussels sprout leaves, just use them like kale or like collard greens. They're a little bit smaller. And the other thing is, I like that they got the red stem or the purple stem in there. Of course, the other thing you could use also is things like broccoli leaves. So we got, you know, the broccoli's making the broccoli, but you could also harvest your broccoli leaves to eat, just like kale. You know, you don't have to just use your broccoli and not use the leaves. I want you guys to use the leaves of all your brassica family plants. These are highly anti-cancer, anti-aging, and helps your liver with stage 2 detoxification. So yeah, I mean, I have just endless amounts of greens in here. I think this is probably some cauliflower greens that haven't formed yet. The cauliflower heads haven't formed. We're gonna go ahead and pick some other greens here. And of course, my favorite greens are my tree collard greens. So this happens to be a tree collard cross, and I don't know what the cross is. But we're gonna harvest some of these greens off the top, and wow, they're not quite as tender and young. They're a lot more strong because they've grown through last summer and now into the winter. Right, the next green I want to harvest for you guys and put into the smoothie is arugula. Arugula, also known as rocket, can be hot and spicy a lot, and mine is bolting, so it's gonna be spicy. But what I'm gonna do, instead of picking the nice large leaves, I'm gonna pick just some of the top growth, some of the baby greens that are not gonna be quite as strong. And we're gonna probably, once again, pick a dozen of these leaves. You know, what I'm really trying to do is I'm trying to really get a wide variety and eat more different kinds of greens. There's scientific studies showing that the wider the diversity of your diet and the different kinds of foods you eat, the better the health and the more diversity you will have in your microbiome. And this is some new emerging science. This is going to be really important in the future, guys. So listen up. try to eat as many different kinds of plants, foods as you possibly can. And that's why I'm trying to, you know, mix up and eat lots of different kinds of leafy greens in my diet. They all have different nutrients and, of course, different kinds of fiber. All right, so what I want to harvest next is my understory plants of the fig trees that are in pots. Link down below to the video where I show about keeping your soil active in your potted trees. Very important. My fig trees are coming out of their dormancy, but more importantly, the cilantro I planted right below are going to flower and going to be ending pretty soon. So what I like to do when they're going to flower is I just come and just, I'll top them off and just pop off the tops, right? And the tops could go in our smoothie. You know, cilantro is known as a heavy metal detoxifier in our body. So I'm going to encourage you guys to eat it regularly. Just because it's flowering doesn't mean it's no longer good. It actually has a nice, stronger flavor. So we're not going to harvest a bunch of it, but we're going to basically pop off a lot of these tops. Later in the week, I'll be harvesting most of these tops actually to add to my vegetable juice. But right now, we're just going to go ahead and pop off some flowering tops for the green smoothie. You guys don't need to use these exact greens. John, I can't make your recipe. I don't have those exact greens, right? Don't worry about it. If you only got lettuce, harvest lettuce greens. If you only got kale, harvest kale greens. If you got a bunch of things, harvest a little bit of each. You know, I don't have to use these greens. I can use any greens in my garden. I could harvest all kale. I could have harvested all this. I like to mix it up whenever possible to kind of get, you know, greater diversity of nutrients, but use whatever you got. So the last green I'll be using today is the purple Mizuna. I love this guy a lot. Look at this. He's nice and purple. These grew super fast, even in the cold winter. But now that the weather's warming up, it also bolts really fast too. So I've been knocking these guys back as well. To try to keep them growing a little bit longer. Also had some watering issues, so I got a lot more stuff dried out since I was underwatering, which also probably didn't help with the bolting because it probably caused them to stress out and bolt even more. So now I got a huge bowl of greens that we're gonna go ahead and make a smoothie with. So now I'm gonna make a green smoothie with all those fresh greens that we harvested, as well as some other ingredients to ramp up the nutrition. Now green smoothies don't have to be this hard. It can be simple as water, like frozen bananas, and some greens from your garden. So I want you guys to go out and buy when you see those bananas at the grocery store, like in those bags, or when they're banded and they're overripe and they sell them for half price or pennies on the dollar. Buy them, peel them, and freeze them in Ziploc bags or actually vacuum sealable bags, and then have those available so that you can make a green smoothie whenever you want. Instead of using water, you could use coconut water. I, of course, today am using orange juice that we just made. Using the white pith of the orange as well as the oranges. That's why it's a bit more deeper, richer color. A lot more vitamin C and bioflavonoids in here when you juice it that way. And today I'm not, you could use any old blender you guys have. You guys have an Osterizer, a Waring, whatever blender you guys could use, a Vitamix. Those will all work great. That being said, I'm into doing things the best way possible, including growing a garden the best way possible for the most nutrition and using the appliances that allow you to maximize your nutrition. You know, it's shown that in studies, the vacuum blender, right, will preserve up to 3 times more of certain polyphenols and air-sensitive nutrients. Plus, also, you're not going to have all the extra air injected into the smoothie, so you're going to have less gas and bloating. You're going to have stronger flavors, which actually somebody that I sold the vacuum blender to said, the flavors are too strong, John, I want to return the blender. Which, you know, hey, if you guys like weak flavors, don't get the vacuum blender, guys. But if you guys want strong flavors and more nutrition, use a vacuum blender. So, Wendy, I know you've been using a vacuum blender for a little bit based on my recommendation. What are your thoughts comparing standard traditional blending to vacuum blending?
I love it. It's, the color is better, and I get to drink the smoothie slower throughout the day, and it wouldn't separate as much.
And the flavor stays. It doesn't, like, yeah. The flavor doesn't go, like, if you make a banana smoothie with greens, like in a standard blender, and you don't drink it immediately and you let it sit, it starts tasting really bad.
And it'll get runny really fast, like separate.
Mm.
Yeah.
All right, so we got basically 1 quart of OJ in there. Now we got 2 little pints of organic blueberries, and these were organic navel oranges. We're gonna put the blueberries in there first. Always load your blender up with the most liquidy ingredients first. And then as a special treat, because I know Wendy loves it so much, we got some organic dragon fruit. Cheapest place to buy this is Costco, if they still sell it. Of course, I think Sprouts Farmers Markets and other places will sell this in a smaller package, but I buy things in bulk and I grow things in bulk. We're gonna just dump the rest of them in there.
Gosh,
purple dragon fruit. I encourage you guys to eat purple foods once again. So we got the purple greens for my garden. We got the purple blueberries and the purple dragon fruit. Ramp up those anthocyanins for their health benefits. Wow, and this carafe's almost full. Like, we could have room for the greens. So on the greens,
stuff them in.
What we're gonna do is I'm just gonna take them and I'm just gonna break them up a little bit as I throw them into the blender so that they all fit, and then maybe kind of push them down in to the liquid. All right, so we got all the greens in there. It fit amazingly.
Yeah.
And now the secret of vacuum blending is we're gonna go ahead and put on the vacuum seal lid that makes a nice tight, airtight seal. And then we got the vacuum pump. Vacuum blending is pretty much like a standard blender, but what happens is you pull out the excess oxygen out of the carafe before you blend. So you're blending in an oxygen deprived environment. You know, when I saw vacuum blending at the trade show many years ago, I was instantly a fan because I understood it, but then I better understood it once I tasted the difference. And I do sell vacuum blenders, and that's my real job for a living, my day job. If you guys want to get this vacuum blender, which is the best one on the market for making things like vacuum juicing, which is next level juicing, you could check me out at my other YouTube channel called Discount Juicers, or my website, discountjuicers.com, link down below to buy this very vacuum blender. So once the vacuum pump automatically turns off, we could just go ahead and pull this off. And now I really like this blender because it's a smart blender. You just have a one-touch button, so we're probably gonna hit maybe the pulse button once and then the blend button once, and that's all we need to do. It'll run for about a minute total, and then it'll be done and turn itself off automatically. All right, so there we have it. Shut off automatically, take this off, and now we're gonna go ahead and pull this little lid and listen carefully. You can hear all the air rush back in there. Pull off this lid. And look at our nice, delicious purple smoothie. All right, Wendy, here, we're gonna let you guys try yours first. Look at that nice, rich purple.
Thick.
Nice and thick. Our greens are totally ground up, so we get the maximum bioavailability and best digestion. All right, to your health, purple smoothies.
To health and happiness. Oh, it's so good.
That's good. I mean, what do you taste?
Coriander.
I taste the greens.
Arugula.
I taste the coriander greens. It's actually kind of sweet, though, so it's not like, ugh, this is nasty. It's like, well, this is almost like they should serve this in every McDonald's.
Fast food. Fast food.
Mm-hmm.
Mmm.
Mmm.
So good. The OJ really helps to cut out
it all bound. Yeah, you really don't taste the greens. You kind of taste the strong ones. Like the arugula and the cilantro.
I really like those, yeah.
And I like those too. Yeah, really, the cilantro is kind of overpowering, actually.
Yeah. The cilantro and the arugula come second, I think, for me.
Yeah, I mean, otherwise, I mean, it just tastes like kind of a like semi-sweet, not super sweet.
It's just the way I like it, yeah.
Because we got the berries in there and the dragon fruit. Yeah. Those aren't necessarily that sweet. But they kind of add, also, too, the dragon fruit was cold. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of like a more thicker kind of texture.
Yeah, it really helps in a smoothie if you're looking for that that thickness and like that full body. If you always think about like smoothies, you picture like frozen fruits, right? That really helps with
the greens. Wow. One amazing, helpful smoothie for you. Now, Wendy, I get to eat your stuff. So let's go ahead and transition and get your stuff, your tacos made.
Okay, let's go pick some ingredients. Now I'm going to be harvesting some greens and herbs so I can make my recipe. Starting off with this mizuna. This is very nice and mild. I think it would be kind of a good texture and very neutral for my recipe. Ooh, you know what's kind of fun too? It's got these. This is a red vine sorrel. This would be a very nice flavor, I think, to add to the taco thing that I've been making. These are grown in the shade, so they're a lot more mild and delicate tasting. And also, you probably can stretch out the growing season a little longer when you grow it in part shade. Whenever I harvest my vegetables, I like to kind of go around and harvest a few here and there so that I kind of make it look like, you know, you haven't really touched the plant. I don't like to just get the plant all bald, so it just stresses out the plant and takes longer for them to grow back. And as I'm picking, I'm also kind of pruning. Whichever ones that are spreading out too far is shading off the other ones. I think that gives me a good reason to pick, because sometimes when the plants grow so pretty, I don't even really want to touch them, but this gives me a good reason to harvest, to eat, and for the plants to actually be happy that, you know, they're growing, putting out more for me to pick. What's really nice about Mizuna is that it just stays tender. Even the older stems, they're still really tender. Okay, thank you. Let's move on.
What did I say? Arugula.
Yes, arugula. Let's pick some of these. I'm gonna pick the top, the smaller, the new leaves, so that it stays a little more mild, but I really like that toasty, nutty flavor of arugula. I try to get the new growth, but not too close to the bolting part because it gets more spicy. It's definitely good for you and if you like the kick, but I think I'm gonna keep it a little light for this recipe. Okay, next let's go pick some coriander, or we call it cilantro. Okay. Smells so good. I actually really like the more bolted ones because it smells stronger. And to me, it actually gets this more like floral kind of a smell to it. It's just so good. I love it when they go to flower too. I love using those in salads and dressings. Okay, let's go get the last ingredient. Look at this green onion. They love the sun and they're doing so well out here in the cold. Thank you, plant. Smells so good. This is such a pretty decoration too. Okay, I'm good. We are going to add these with the stuff that's been cooking. To make the wrap, I'm gonna pick this beautiful purple bok choy. Look at this, it's almost black color, this deep, deep purple. This would make a really great size wrap. Stays very neutral, the flavor. Look at that.
Broken, so perfect.
All right, let's put this together. Just got some greens picked out, the red vein sorrels and, you know, the mizunas. I'm just going to chop those up along with this flowering green onions. Just make them all small, like a mixed salad kind of thing. These ones are going to be the purple bok choy. Will wrap everything, will go on this like a plate to eat. I've sliced these up. This is the sunchokes. Got some in the pressure cooker, and then these I'm just gonna save some for adding a bit, like the raw ones, into the salad. And then also got this beautiful dehydrated cherry tomatoes that just finished in the kitchen.
Just came out of the dehydrator.
Yeah, just got out of the dehydrator. Yeah, so those will be really good and flavorful to add to the mix. And then to make the dressing, got some miso. This is a red miso. I usually use the yellow or the white ones, but low sodium is the most important to me. And then because of low sodium, I guess if you want, you can. Hey, the regular one is actually really, really salty.
It's too salty. So then you could moderate the salt by adding your own salt in addition. So you'll probably still have lower sodium.
Exactly.
And I encourage you guys to eat a very low sodium or maybe no added sodium diet. You know, we don't really need extra sodium in our life.
Yeah. And then to make the sauce really creamy and to kind of thicken it up, using some macadamia nuts. I really like macadamia nuts because it's very creamy, but you can use any kind of nuts, even like sunflower or pumpkin seeds. That would do also. I just really like that creaminess from that. And then pineapple juice that John had pre-made, just like 2 hours ago. Super fresh. Okay, so let me just chop all this up and mix it up, and then we'll get started with making the dressing. Just got all this chopped up. Just gonna dump these deliciousness in. And a little bit of microgreens. This is a mixed microgreen.
And where are the microgreens from?
Locosano Greens.
Locosano right Greens, fresh in harvested Vegas. In Las Vegas. So we're eating more local food.
7 different microgreens blend.
This is probably one of the healthiest things you guys could eat. And, you know, many of you guys, it's still the winter time. You can't be planting outside yet. So I want you guys to grow some microgreens.
Look how beautiful this mix is coming.
Yeah, it's looking amazing. It smells so good, too. I could smell it.
Lots of different herbs and crunchy textures. Oh, I forgot. I got to add this in, too.
This is the raw sunchokes.
Yes.
And so you would make something like this, Wendy, at home? Normally for yourself?
Sometimes.
Wow. I don't make stuff like this. I keep it simple.
Yeah.
Soup, salad, smoothies, juices.
Yeah, but I have to say I do make juices the most. Mm. And then smoothies second. The greens, I usually have a lot of, like, for my juices.
Yeah, because you could use a lot of greens up really fast.
Yep. And I have a lot of huge ashitaba.
I love the ashitaba stock juice.
Yes.
It's my favorite.
Yeah. Okay, so
right, this is nice looking really good.
Yeah. Let me just move this aside. And...
So now you're going to make the dressing?
Yes, make the dressing. So I'm just going to throw 2 cloves of garlic, as many as you like, or skip it if you don't want any. I just think with such sweet, fruity, like pineapple juice for the dressing, I kind of like, I think, there you go. The garlic gives it a little more savory. Oh my God, that smells so good. Let's try that much. Macadamia nuts.
Grown in Hawaii. Dehydrated macadamias. Try one of those. Try one of those, Wendy. Like, I know you've never had mine.
No, I never.
Yeah, so try them and compare them to ones you've bought before.
Hmm. Is this raw?
Absolutely.
Wow. Really good tasting.
Yeah,
they're creamy.
They're creamy and sweet. Yeah.
Hmm.
I try to source the best ingredients I can. Makes a difference. It just ups the amplitude of your recipes. It just makes it that much better.
Yeah.
You're using good ingredients.
Yes, absolutely. I think this is really good with like a pepper sauce too, a sweet pepper sauce.
Actually, I made that yesterday. Great minds think alike.
Okay. I don't want to use up all John's ingredients.
Use them all. I got a lot more.
Okay.
Whatever you need to make it work. And last time they shorted me 0.2 pounds when I bought 10 pounds.
What?
I won't mention the names.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Hey, and then miso. Oh my goodness. Gotta have the miso. I'll try it first, make sure it's... Mmm.
All right, just put the lid on, put the pump on, press the pump button, and let it suck. It's sucking.
Okay.
All right, all done.
Let's try this. It's a good consistency.
So you've made this kind of like sauce before?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's a really nice consistency. It's like mayonnaise, basically.
Yeah. Which is actually really addicting with the if you dip the sunchokes in.
Mm. Oh, I bet.
I can use a little more salt. It's very like a sweet.
Yeah, I mean it's fresh pineapple. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean that's really sweet.
Well, maybe just a little bit of salt. That's why. Some salt back in. Do you want to help me? Thank you.
How much do you want in there?
I'll let you know.
That much.
Okay, salt. Thank you. I think I can just restir.
Yeah.
Mmm. I taste the saltiness, that mineral from the and the
salt. Yeah, you don't even need to add salt when you got good greens. You don't even need seasoning.
Mm. Oh, it smells really good. Okay, it's done. It's gonna just.
It's done. So do you mix it in there, or do you like just pour it separately, or what?
I like to mix it, and then we can drizzle a little more on top if you want extra dressing.
All right, sure.
That way you can make sure that it's all coated solid.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good sauce.
This is the one that was cooked for just 3 minutes in the pressure cooker, and it stayed in there for like probably another hour.
Yeah, while we're making the video.
Yeah. So this is the purple sweet potatoes and sunchokes from John's Garden. And then this is the salad, a bunch of different, you know, the mix that I chopped up with the microgreen blend and the dressing. So now we're going to put it on this wrap.
I'd probably use the other. Yeah, I mean, whatever.
So I'm going to put that on here and then put a few. Did you want to be really hot? Yeah. Okay, and then.
More sauce.
More sauce. Do you like it more sauce or do you like a little bit?
Yeah, I like more sauce. Dollop.
Dollop. Okay, why don't you...
Is that mine?
That's yours.
Oh my gosh.
Careful, it's hot and cold. All right.
All right, so what do you call these, Wendy?
Garden tacos.
Garden tacos made pretty much almost entirely from my garden, except for the microgreens.
And the pineapple.
And the pineapple and the mac nuts. But yeah, most of all the ingredients in here, including the leaves, are from my garden. This is how I want you guys to... prepare your food. All right, so let's try these. To your health.
To my health.
Wow. The dehydrated tomato really makes it like nice, crunchy, and then you get that flavor burst. I like that this is a little bit warm, but not. It's not scalding or super hot.
Yeah.
The sauce is good. Pineapple sauce to me is like eating pineapple pizza. Like you might not think it goes, but it actually works.
Yeah. And the miso cuts out a little bit of that extreme fruitiness.
Exactly. The miso and like the more salt.
Mm-hmm.
Mmm. I never knew stuff from my garden could taste so amazing.
It's really good. That sweet potato, that starchiness and gooey.
Exactly. Mm. And then the crunchiness of the sunchokes.
Yeah.
And that's a nice neutral flavor. Like the sunchokes just add a nice kind of actually potato texture. And actually the cooked ones taste kind of like potatoes to me.
Yeah.
Because I've never really had sunchokes like heat processed before.
Yeah.
I think we're going to have to harvest some more purple bok choy leaves so we can like make a bunch more.
Yeah.
Mmm.
It's addicting.
I think we better just turn off the camera now and eat.
Yeah.
So Wendy, any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers today about making your own food from your garden?
Yeah, I highly encourage it because it is so much fun and gets you more connected and involved in rather than just like looking and admiring the beauty that you can actually take in and feel even more a part of your garden. And it's such a pleasure to be able to pick from John's garden, and he actually liked my food.
It's actually quite, you're going to have to come over and make it. And I know some of you guys are thinking, John, you should like take her and have her be your girlfriend. She has a boyfriend, maybe he'll be in the video later or not. So we're not going to be together, but she makes some amazing food. And the reason for this video is because I really want to encourage you guys to make more fresh foods from your garden. Try to keep as many ingredients as you can raw, just like Wendy did. Maybe a few things that are heated. But it could taste amazing and far exceed just trying to go out to a restaurant to eat or getting prepared foods, you know, what you guys grow at home. Number one, it's the highest quality. You cannot buy food this good. So my greens and even, you know, just prepare it yourself with the love, care, and intention. And when I was filming Wendy harvesting some of the greens, it was like, wow, she's like a chef. And it's like, high-end chefs like grow gardens so they can have better quality food. All you gardeners out there have high quality food. Now you need to become a chef and start experimenting and dabbling in the kitchen to get more of your greens, more of your fruits and vegetables into that you grow in creative and fun ways. So hopefully you guys enjoy this episode. If you guys want more videos with Wendy and I making food fresh, because she does it on her own, I do it on my own, but this is the first time we ever got together and made food together. It was quite fun. Hey, thumbs this video up because it helps out the YouTube algorithm to get this video out to more people. And also be sure to share this with other people that are gardeners so that they could start creating and inspire them to create their own recipes using the food that they sourced and grew in their very garden. So Wendy, if somebody wants to get a hold of you, watch your videos on your channel, how could they do that?
Go to Wendland.
Go to Wendyland. It's like going to Disneyland. All right, so link down below to Wendyland, her channel. Check her out. Subscribe. I'm already subscribed. I love her channel. She has so many good, informative videos that are a little bit shorter than mine, actually. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes that are coming out every 5 to 7 days. You don't know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. Past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time teach you guys how to grow your own high-quality food at home. And sometimes even prepare it into some of the healthiest recipes that you guys make on the planet. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.